I mean, so I'm also the Olympian Witches March organizer. We did that in June with Winning. We are organizing now the Indigenous People's Day. Yes, so why don't you talk about that?
Well, in 2015, the city of Olympia, they decided to make October the first Monday of every October Indigenous People's Day, and usually Columbus Day. This year, we will be honoring our women. We also invite all and every Indigenous people to come celebrate with us. We're going to be inviting Indigenous women from all over to come and speak. And we will also be inviting Indigenous dancers, like the Maori, the Aztec, the Siberian dancers. I'm trying to find a Celtic or Scottish crew. And we will also have Indigenous food vendors downtown. And so they're all invited. October 9th. Would you like to introduce yourself now, Eva?
Sure. I'm Eva Greitzinger, my own independent Chief Spirit Media. I basically think of myself as an activist more than anything else, first and foremost. The one thing that I want to recognize is that we are on Coast of Haitian lands. That's the first and foremost thing that I want to recognize. Coast of Haitian lands is basically a mixture of Coast of Haitian territory nations, and they all met up here in Olympia, and they used to use this area with the Nisqually and Duwamish tribes as a trade post area. So we need to recognize that first and foremost. But I am Irish, German, Scottish, basically everything mixed. 60% of me is that, and about 40% of me is Santee Sioux. Sioux Nations from Nebraska, Niagara, Nebraska. I grew up and was raised basically in Omaha, Nebraska, the Midwest, circular areas such as, you know, Tulsa, Oklahoma, and I've stayed in Iowa for a while, in Des Moines and other areas. So I circulated around the Midwest and learned a lot about racism and hate. And I learned that those are not things that I want anything to do with. So moved here and pretty much became just a straight full-time activist from there, and I haven't stopped since.
So what are some of the campaigns that you've been involved with and what you're working on now?
Well, the biggest campaign I'm working on right now would be the Puyallup Nations tribe fighting no LNG right down the street from here in Tacoma. We've been out there, basically, they have been out there fighting it for almost 2 years now. On a continuous basis, going through city council and fighting down there at the court and trying to stay in courts and just fight through it and not allow them to come. So they fought through it, and basically the pipeline wasn't allowed to be built. So basically what they're fighting down there is they're fighting an LNG pipeline, which is a natural gas, quote unquote, fracked gas pipeline. And what they do is they're going to take all of the fracked gas that comes in from Canada and turn it into liquid natural gas for people to use, you know, throughout the area and through export, I'm guessing. They're saying that they're not going to use it for export, but when you have 500,000 gallons of liquid natural gas, there's no way the state of Washington can use that. Plus, they're trying to put in another LNG plant and on the other side of Washington, too. Mm-hmm. So, you know, why do we need two LNG plants here? Well, we're right next to the seas. It's great export. So, basically, they're fighting it because, well, they've lost pretty much, I'd say, about 80% of their salmon run that they get every single year. The salmon have literally gone from 4 foot all the way down to, we're talking salmon. You guys know how big they are now. And literally, they used to be 4 foot salmon. And I was told by stories by elders from here Yeah, there were a total of, back before colonialism existed, they couldn't count the number of orcas that there were. Back in 1962, they did a study, and there were over 2,000 orcas. And, you know, every single year, they would have more and more orcas come out. Well, with all of the whale population that we've been basically going after, there's nothing left almost. I mean, you might see one or two orcas out here in the Salish Seas now. There's nothing. And Tokatai needs to be brought home. That's the number one thing. That's the biggest thing because she's now an adult, you know. And
Tokatai is the orca that took the sea world.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
yes. And has been held in captivity since 1972. So this is, I mean, yeah, and she was an infant. So, you know, she needs to be released back to the wild where she belongs, you know. It's sad that, you know, we've been doing this for so long and we've been hurting animals for so long. It's not just one or two things that, you know, we're down here fighting. We're down here literally fighting for not only the fish, but the fact that they have tribal lands down there, right next to the port, like, that are literally given to them, that they have not sold off, that they are not going to sell off. And this pipeline was to be put on these lands, and instead of putting it on these lands, they're putting it underneath a high school and underneath a main street port.
And this is an earthquake zone, so it's not a matter of when are there going to be, you know, if there's going to be failures. There will be failures.
It's when, and
already we have elders, you know, telling stories of how the salmon used to be, where even myself, in my own heartbreak and spirituality of things that I have seen, I remember clamming with my Asian friends in Tacoma and getting seaweed. I remember just 5 years ago, you could stand in Capitol Lake and see dozens of seagulls just hovering, and they were dead in the street for a few years. Now they're gone. This is not only. Those are members of my community. Those seagulls are my friends, you know? And I think that, especially in the pagan community, we know we have our familiars, you know? And we understand when you have a tree and a bird is in it and it lives and it has food, that's your friend, you feed them. They're, you know? I mean, so when we look at these stories, we need to bring this native spirituality into ourselves, you know? I've never spoken at city council. I'm ready to tell them, hey, you know, the clams and the seagulls and the kelp, that's my friends, and they're dead, they're gone. And they try to say, oh, the herring left. Well, why'd the herring leave? Because the water is dead. You don't need to be, you know, 40% centi or however percent anything, or connect to your Celtic roots to see the death and to have that affect your soul. We need to bring that indigenous spirit, no matter what your faith is, and really have a fire for this, because water is life. Mini Wachoni, water is life. I learned at Standing Rock, it is not just water is life. It is all of creation. Water is everything that is living. It's Aphrodite and Oshun and all of these different goddesses, and it's always water and love, water and power. You know, water and the sea, but, you know, it has so much power to move. But we're killing. You know, they have looked at with Buddhist studies and consciousness studies, the vibration of water. You can tell water is bad, tell water is good. We are mostly water, you know, and we look at water as external, or the fight with the LNG or at Standing Rock is external, and it is not. It is the molecules that make us, you know. So, yeah, I really feel that a lot of people feel like Standing Rock is over, or where do I go help? There's a lot of places to help, to donate $5 or $1 to just take time to sit and remember, okay, where do I want to put my energy, and share a post, an event, come to places like these, go. They did it the 37-mile. This is the shirt I'm wearing. I provided massage support and a batch of tonic, anti-inflammatory, witchy tonic, for the Protect the Salish Seas. This is Tokatai. Super healing and good. So this is Walk to Protect our Salish Sea, to bring home Tokatai. So I was given this at the Duwamish Longhouse. So there's lots of ways to support.
before, I couldn't walk 37 miles. I have health problems. A lot of people can't march. Women's march are different things, but if you want to support even just once, you will make friends that share the same beliefs as you, and you will find that there is a lot of wisdom from people of all different, two-spirit, matriarchal lineage locally, people from other tribes, Choctaw, that I have met. It is there, and I really believe, that's why I asked them here, and I'm glad you all are here. I said, this is a receptive audience. They said, was it native-led? Are there natives? Well, I said, we're the natives, and there will be people there to listen. So I want to thank you and hold that space with you here now. Because we are all indigenous. We are all indigenous to this planet. This is our planet. The ocean and the air, that is our body. You know, the mountain ashes are bones, our food. So I feel like we have to sit in that more. Now, when you're going to have mutual respect and not in your heart be a colonizer, then you have mutual respect for the people here. You know what I mean? So then you have to honor that. So thank you all for being here. This is how we honor each other, you know, is by sharing all. If you have any question ever, just raise your hand.
Shortly after Standing Rock, I had another yoga in the Capitol where I invited all the Washington State tribal leaders to come participate. And they were able to express what's going on in their home territories. Like we have the Lummi, there's going to be an oil pipeline put above their reservation, above there in Canada. And then like the Quinault, they had a, you know, ocean of fracking. You know, there's just like a lot of things going on. Even here, you know, we have a coal train passing through. So there's a lot of things to get connected into. You know, it's not just Tacoma. We have our own grassroots things that are going on here. My tribe, we've had to deal with mining companies. So I believe it's all connected, because when they do these things, like pick up our Mother Earth and raping her, they're also raping our women. They have all these male camps set up everywhere. And I believe another indigenous women are, Native American women are some of the most oppressed and suppressed women. But I believe that when we help heal our Native women and we help tackle these issues in the environment and you know that we're able to uplift them, and you know there's healing in that, there's healing for everybody. I don't want to say it's like a pyramid, you know, because that's like a patriarchal, you know, man on top, and you know, the poor people on the bottom. But when I say when we heal our women, you know, then they're able to be confident again, and there's love and nurturing. All a circle instead of a pyramid, because we're all connected.
There's so much I can say to go from there. So also I wanted to add there's the Xylene plant in Anacortes. If you guys don't know about that, they're trying to expand the Xylene plant in Anacortes. Mm. And that's one of the most polluted areas in all of the Northern States. So just to let you guys be included in that too. That Xylene plant, basically they want to expand it and make it so that there's less pollution
It's just like waking up. Whether you're a biologist or native and your people have always been here, or you come here and you're realizing your spirituality connection to the earth, it's all the same thing. And it really blows my mind that on the whole West Coast, people from all walks of life are into nature, like rednecks like nature, you know? And there's redneck revolt that aren't racist, you know what I mean? And all these people that are trying to hold the space, but I really believe deeply that Minimucho water is life. People from all over focusing on that, like, has got to be a solution. So, I mean, whether it's how we vote or people needing to vote, not really, because it's just like, oh, I vote because of what's happening, but getting together and having these conversations and spreading the word that mutual respect and water, like, it makes sense on so many levels, you know? I mean, you can't argue with the fool that everyone else is, you know? I have had moments sitting thinking about things going on in the world, just in the tub, and then it's just like, this is sacred as fuck, just me in the tub here with the water. Or thinking about a mother with the baby in a tub with the water, like, that is so beautiful. And how that is taken away from people over the world, locally, and I just feel like, you know, Flint is Minimucho. You're taking the life out of and putting pain in it. And so, bringing that deep spirituality breath, asking our gods and our ancestors to come back, because that energy, no matter how you look at it, that energy needs to come back. We need to ask the gods of water to speak to us, to speak in people's hearts, to flow in people, to realize that clean water Mother Nature gave that to us. Everybody had access to it. You could just walk somewhere and get it, you know? And now we're burning everything up and poisoning and making people buy it and all of these things. So that's the thing about this beautiful about pagans. We agree to disagree about everything. Of course we don't agree. We have all different gods. That's fine. We can all put some water in our cup at our altar, you know? Get different, be mindful of, you can bring water from places and put it together. Make your own virgin fountain of all the clear water you've brought into your life from all the places you've been. And really focus that this is sacred, and we need to rise that vibration across boundaries, across all of the boundaries. I really believe it's something we have to lay on very, very deeply, you know? Yes, because people disagree on so many things, and it's easy to disagree on so many things, but to hold it as sacred, we have to amplify that in our society. Gender, belief, color,
and every religion, every belief has a water prayer. I've looked it up, every single one, you know, even my belief, Wiccan, you know, we have a water prayer. There's a water prayer in everything, in every religion, every belief, in every section of life, there is a water prayer. And if you don't have one and you're Wiccan, make your own, because that's what we can do. So, you know, I mean, it's easy. Make a water prayer. Find it in yourself, you know, find your best place that you can, and just sit there and pray with the water, and you will not believe how beautiful it is. It's magical. You know, I sit out when I've had a bad week or a bad month, and I just can't hold myself together anymore. I literally go to the water, and that's why I moved here to Seattle. Like, to be 100% honest with you guys, I moved to Washington because it's next to water. And I lived in Omaha because I was right next to the Missouri. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I stayed near water all my life because I know water is life. You know, when you wake up in the morning and splash water on your face, it brings you to life. You know what I mean? It takes that sleep out of your eyes and that sleep out of your face, and it brings you up to life. It wakes you up. You know, that's a natural coffee. Throw some cold water on your face, I guarantee you, you're waking up. So, it's just, you know, it's not just water is life. Water is everything to us. Not only, you know, and I know this as somebody who's studied botany a lot, water keeps plants alive, no matter what the plant. I mean, even if it's a bonsai plant, that bonsai plant still needs water once every 2 weeks. You know, it needs water. Everything needs water to live. 90% of the human body is water.
like I just heard recently too that there was a bill passed by the military where they're going to be able to fly over certain areas and have like warfare games, where they're able to have some kind of radiation machine where they're able to fly their jets down really low. We're here in Olympia, you know, we're here at the state capitol, we're able to pass legislative bills here, like the military just recently passed. So we need to do something to counteract that.
And pagans love the many gods, no masters, but I know at the Women's March, I heard so many pagans and Wiccans screaming, and I feel like we are really powerful. There are a lot of us. We're growing, especially out here. And I think it's a very unifying group of people that are coming together differently. You know, I think the internet has fueled a lot of people that are solitary looking, you know, for meaning. And I think that brings people together. And then people realize, okay, we have a lot of these common beliefs here, you know. And I feel like I really believe something can happen there. We have to start organizing, if not around control and power, around the elements, around the sacredness of that these elements are calling to us to speak for them. You know, the earth and farming, so many different things are against nature when nature grows these beautiful jungles and forests that provide everything. And as people, we should have the knowledge and intention to make that even better. There are native gardens, they have found places in the woods that have been long abandoned that are still growing better because of how it was set up. Now we call that pogo culture or something. But I mean, there is wisdom that has been there, you know? And if we just work with Mother Nature and work together and join together, we can do that. There are a lot of organizations around that I feel are doing sacred work around food and water, but there's so much split. And people like that because you need your small communities, but how churches and colleges and the military work is they have all these separate people doing things, but they are connected by something. And we can be connected by water. We are already connected by water. The water is screaming for us to become connected and figure out how to do that. But it's more than just marching for LNG or going to Standing Rock. It does have to be within our hearts. I love your soul. I look into your eyes, okay. It has to be within our hearts. It has to be within our hearts and spirit. You know, when you look in people's eyes, and all of you really, you just see the intent and the action. When I was asking them to come about, you know, what it would be like, I said, these are the people that are going to be listening with their eyes and their hearts and their souls and know who to bring this conversation to and be like, hey, we got to vote against this. Don't you have a friend Tacoma? You got to be against LNG. And don't you have a friend somewhere? The word has to get out. You know, a lot of people just play on their phones, go to work, and take for granted their clean shower in the morning. You know, when there really is work to be done, the word does have to be spread. You know, a lot of times I don't vote unless I think there's something important to vote on, you know? Some people are like that too, just figuring out how we can put energy in so many ways. Yes, we need boots on the ground. Yes, people need donations to their legal fund. Yes, we need to support so many of these different communities and show up, go to a powwow, put a dollar down in front of the kids dancing, you know what I mean? Give that honor to people and be conscious about putting your energy out to spread the word about all these different things. I mean, people talk about all different kinds of prophecies and the apocalypse and stuff, but Native spirituality has the prophecies of coming together and healing the hoop. Okay, these are prophecies we need to try and make happen. You know what I mean? You know, we can do this. I feel like our power has been taken away, and so then we have no masters and we find it back, but we need to master ourselves and come together in this beautiful way that pagan and Natives and anarchists and all kinds of people do work. You do what you do and it works. You know, I mean, Antifa still organizes and there's no leaders. You know what I mean? So you come together and you amplify that energy and you bring it and spread it, and then more things will happen where we can bring our energies to these issues and spread the words that people want to vote and run. We need pagans running for office. You know, Renata Rollins has been boots on the ground with homelessness, and she's a hedge witch. She's open about that. I was wondering if she was going to be. And I invited her to speak at Witches March, and I honored her on that one, too. And she's like, yes, I'm a hedge witch. But that's just it. Even bringing paganism into our extended families, however much we do or don't talk to them because of spirituality, there's a lot of Christian garden and kitchen witches. Just bringing that power back to yourself, then once you have that power, then you can bring that power out into the community and out and back into the forest and give that energy back to the waters and get this estuary back the way it's supposed to be and get this dam down back here and free the lake, because that is a blockage of the waters and it's blocking the healing of the sound and the fish and the birds, all of those things. These are issues that, you know, you have to keep pushing, you have to keep pushing, you have to keep rising. That energy, please do. You know, you've done work with murdered and missing indigenous women as well. Why don't you talk with us a little bit more about that?
Well, with the missing and murdered women, indigenous women, there was an I Don't Know Why movement that brought forth that, and that was mainly in Canada, where a lot of the missing murdered women are indigenous women. Their cases were becoming unresolved. Families, they really wanted to gonna be a time, you know, because again, you know, we believe things are becoming circular, it keeps making the same mistakes, and how we see it now, like in Venezuela, you know, a lot of the people are suffering down there and starving. And, you know, there's a lot of governments who are collapsing, and, you know, our people are, in the US government, they're all scrambling. And get all these resources. And so, yes, it's all connected.
Goddess has to come back because we can grow all of our resources. And now that we have a lot of advances in technology, I feel like the way to reason with capitalists is that there's money in green infrastructure. And, you know, they're connecting that nature regenerates and that we can grow hemp and bamboo and all these other oils and things in a way that's in harmony, and that there's better nutritional value in organic and natural wild harvested food. All of these different things are really returning to an indigenous, earth-based, mother-based, goddess-based mindset.
Can I add to that?
Please do. Mm-hmm.
So hemp, I want everybody to know first and foremost, like when people come at you with the we need oil for cars, mm-hmm. we need fuel for cars, we need this, no you don't. To be honest with you, the first cars that ever drove on kerosene and hemp. That's what they drove on. Like that's the way that they drove all the way up until 1922 when they came out with this thing called crude oil that they pulled out of the ground from high complacency. Basically they put pressure into the ground just like they do with fracking and pulled the oil up. And that's how they got it. So, I mean, we need to come to the realization that we can do this again. We can go back to the same America that we had, you know, the way that it was, but not the way it was. You know what I mean? Because
let's go forward
right,
to
exactly,
a new America.
Exactly. So we can keep moving forward with a new America and, you know, tell everyone else to do the same thing. I mean, literally at this point in time, if you guys don't know, if you haven't researched it, if you haven't researched global warming and everything that's going on, then please do. Because literally at this point in time, the scientists say we have 1 year left to change. If we don't make that change within 1 year, we're done. That's it. There's no going back. We're screwed. Forever. Ultimately, we are going to end. The planet will end. Our fracking will end. The oil will end. And if you guys haven't been paying attention overseas, there's land craters at this point in time. And what I mean by land craters is literally the land is falling into the middle of Earth. Like, all the way down.
Well, the water is causing voids, it's causing sinkholes on the places all over
just
because
everywhere.
It's out of balance.
Because
it will still stay balanced
right.
energetically.
Because they're pulling oil out of the ground.
I heard that might be something that happened in Russia. I saw a brief headline.
There is one that happened in Russia this last week.
Because
yeah.
they're melting,
yep.
making
yeah.
huge
the,
craters.
This last
yeah.
week, the methane explosions started getting out of control. And actually, now that you mention, 2 days ago there was another one. And it's actually 22 foot wide.
There's huge. I mean, there's
this methane. This methane crater is 22
yeah.
foot wide, the newest one, and that was like 2 days ago. And that's just like
the one in Minneapolis?
In Germany.
Oh.
They're all over.
I don't know
over.
If the one in Minneapolis is methane or not.
The one that happened in Minneapolis, I'm not sure about, to be honest with you. I just know I've been paying attention to all the overseas ones
mm-hmm.
Because that's where the biggest ones have been happening. And in Russia, there's been a new 22 foot one that just came up 2 days ago. So, you know, when you frack, when you put pressure into the earth to pull things out of the ground and leave an empty hole in the ground, trying to not be turned back. So we need to not only start spreading word, but start showing people.
Consciousness is rising through all kinds of people. Every person, it's a whole other thing. Whatever faith you come from or going to or in, as long as you're looking for truth and healing and rising, understanding can always expand. And the more we have these conversations, well, oh, that's the other thing, missing matriarchal indigenous two spirit. I'm saying it in the wrong order. Yeah, tell us about that too. Before we open,
yes,
we'll have more questions and talk more.
Sisters Two Spirit Society NISTS, where our current society right now, who is putting forth the Indigenous People's Day this year for celebration. We are a group of Native, Indigenous women and
of stuff having to do with the Northwest Two Spirit Society, 350 Seattle, Puyallup Tribe of Indians, Duwamish Tribe, basically everyone indigenous around this area that I can get my finger into, I'm there. So with a camera in everyone's face, mostly the cops. But so, I like to keep accountability present. That's actually how this all started. When I first moved here to Washington, I was an activist. I started out an activist, and every now and again, I would just start recording. And it just so happened that the live feeds that I started doing, people were like, "Oh my God, your live feeds are amazing! Like, how do you get such good live feeds? What phone are you using? What are you doing? What Wi-Fi are you using? What are you?" And I'm just like, I'm just gonna start a media company. And I started the media company thinking that I could hold a job. Said I was going to be homeless. So, and the funny thing is I'm homeless, but I'm content and I'm happy with who I am today. I stay in an RV, from my ex-boyfriend, right from my ex-boyfriend's house, and I'm happy with that. I'm happy and I'm content where I'm at today. I don't have money in my pocket. I don't have money in my bank account. I don't have anything. I literally got here because she gave me a ride. So,
but you're always at every.
Yeah.
You were there. You've walked. She walked through her shoes, and the sailors walked. I remember that.
Completely through.
And got gifted new shoes. We need more boots on the ground so that one person isn't walking through their shoes. We need more people.
Puyallup Tribe of Indians donated a pair of awesome brand new shoes from Payless for me. So I have actual tennis shoes to do actions in and stuff now again.
Yeah.
But we do have a PayPal to keep the media company going. The last money that I made, I just took it off of there and sent it from PayPal to my actual bank account. It was $96, and 36 of that went to a new tripod clip.
quite, people pop in with questions whenever, oh, my kid just had a dream, or we post all the different events for all kinds of pagan environmental activism, and it just all goes together with that. So there's always room to connect and boost the conversation. I believe I have a mini Wuchang panel room set up, but there was a information cross to what time check-in was, so I should have had a room yesterday for today, but maybe I can check in after the panel. I'm not sure. We'll see what the management says. But yeah, so there will be more room to connect there, but I would like to open for questions now, so yes.
About establishing like a public space available?
Yeah, because I have the mini Wuchang panel room, you know, reserved for,
oh,
for the thing.
For this?
Yeah, but...
We have a room reserved, but it's, they said it's not going to be open until
check-in.
3.
Checkout is 11, check-in is 3, and room is 1 to 3. we'll see. Hopefully they will be able to open it for me, is what it sounds like. But yes, if anybody has questions or would like to introduce yourself or anything like that, let's open to that. Leave that down.
Can I just finish what I was saying? Sorry.
Sure. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were done.
No, I
okay.
communicate like that sometimes. Sorry. So the registration table, there's the little table on
yeah,
the side
I talked
of it.
To them.
There's that big board for people to sign up for community spaces. It's one of those big, like,
and then mine's on the schedule.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The hotel and all the different people and times of what day,
mm-hmm.
maybe we'll see. But I think we'll be open. We will check on it. Yes.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, I don't have the number yet. They couldn't give it to me. If anybody was wondering about that part, it was listed. So, yes. Just to hold more space and talk about spirituality and Mini Wuchang, and if there's any other questions or more information or anything like that. I do other healing and energy as well and poetry, so I was going to open to questions. If we have questions or anybody would like to speak, and then close with some more. You do, yes.
Talk about us being in Olympia and legislative actions. Do you have a lobby?
I'm also a part of a group called the Indigenous Women's Warrior Society, and we do have a few women in there who are familiar with the legislative process.
Do you want that?
Do
the other groups that you're involved with want people that have relationships with representatives so that they can talk to them? Because oftentimes, way before we get to vote on anything, things are already decided, especially around policy that we don't get a vote on anyway.
Yeah.
And
yes.
So somebody that can be this voice, that can bring the voice of the water, that can bring the voice of the air into representatives' offices,
mm-hmm.
I think
yeah.
it would be extraordinarily powerful.
Me too. I'm definitely looking for those questions. Yes.
I live up in Kitsap County, to the north on the peninsula there. My house just happens to be located on the Suquamish Tribe Reservation, and it's an odd area. Like, I'm wanting to be supportive of the local tribes. You know, I've got Suquamish, there's the Point Casino up past Hansville to the north of Kingston, which is a ferry terminal town. I just don't quite know how to get started with that sort of thing.
All depending on, what kind of help are you looking to give to the Suquamish tribe?
Like, as far as, you know, respecting their sovereignty, as far as legislature in their favor, to help with their, like, with claiming the land that they have, encouraging the arts and the like, just...
Find out what they're doing, having to deal with city council first and foremost. They have a lot of city council meetings that they attend to fight certain things, certain pipelines, certain areas that want to be taken.
Mm-hmm.
They're always involved in city council. I know that for sure.
Okay.
So find out what they're doing with city council week by week. Also, if you just get a hold of the tribe, the actual
mm-hmm.
tribe itself, like if they have a longhouse, which I do believe the Suquamish tribe does have a longhouse.
I know that there's a lengthy building.
Yeah.
That's near
I think it's
a shell
the longhouse.
Station.
Yeah, I think that's. Oh, it's a shell station. Is that what you said?
Yeah, there's a Shell station, then there's a large Western style building that is where they have their tribe headquarters.
That's where they have their headquarters and stuff, that would be their longhouse. I'd get a hold of that place or go there and find out what they're doing. Ask them that question.
There's so many different front lines.
Right.
You know, so like being involved more at the city level and doing things with city council is different than the legislator, is different than other towns with the LNG, is all these different separate tribes. And that's where a lot of the flock comes, is because there's so many different connections. The right hand doesn't know what the left hand's doing, isn't connected to the feet. So, like, how can we do that? So, yeah, legislation is good. Passing Indigenous Peoples Day and not doing Columbus Day, standing the Standing Rock, all these different things, you know, are popping up and happening, you know, in different ways. And there's a lot of umbrella politics that affect all different types of people, whether it's homelessness, LGBTQ2 spirit, or any of those types of things. So just putting your energy into anything, if your intention, which is no all about intention, if your intention is to rise and find out, Facebook has all kinds of information you can find. There's all types of different groups to get plenty of people. That's what I'm saying. If you follow different us and connect with people, that's when you'll find out when this action is happening, when we're marching to something, different days that we're involved in. We've had lots of different marches and rallies at the Capitol and talking with legislature. So bringing all those people's energies together consistently and going forward and rising that energy, that's definitely what we need for people who are a part of this conversation, you know, to continue that. But yes, I definitely want to connect with you on that. It's a lot easier sometimes to get involved in your community or locally or whichever thing. So just adding your energy at any time and you went to that would be great. But yeah, I would like to know more about that. I usually go to things that people already organized. Like I did a lobbying for medical marijuana on the Capitol Day once, you know, and it's like somebody else set that up. So, but yeah, you know, however we can connect within different communities and towns and to do that. The Coast Salish walk that was Duwamish, but then they connected with Puyallup down in Weston and added another part of the walk. So there's all different ways to get connected. If you have that intention, if that seed is planted and you hold it and it grows, it will come. We'll talk online, you'll talk to someone who was that person every day. You're thinking, okay, how, I think I want to go on a walk. What's the next thing? And even, like, I went to Standing Rock because it was there. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I've been to Indigenous Peoples Day. I didn't even know about these different things. And so, but I know people who went for months. I just went and made a donation. Know, the solar panel come back, but then there's things here. So many people here were going to Standing Rock, and it's like, there are like three plants right here that you can, it's not like Standing Rock's over, is it still going? It's just, you can do it right here. So, you know, there's always ways if you just put that intention and that importance in your soul to do that, you know, to help with all these, because it's not a Native issue. And I think pagans understand it's not so much the colonialist viewpoint of Native issues and Native spirituality. This is our planet, this is our water, and this is our spirit, and we can come together because these are important issues for everyone to be on, whether it's on tribal lands or not. I feel like they're putting things on tribal lands just to be assholes. Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah. Do you know?
They're claiming an eminent land, eminent domain. And
exactly.
That's how they're doing it. Yeah.
It seems like it's an extension of them not honoring the treaties and everything.
Yeah.
It is. That's exactly what it is. That's why at every single action that I've been to, we have signs that say honor the treaties. Mm-hmm. Because that's exactly what they're doing. They're not honoring the treaties that they made with us. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? They haven't been honoring the treaties forever. I remember Santee Sioux land was just huge when I was a little kid. You know, the reservation land of Santee Sioux in Niobrara, Nebraska was Niobrara, Nebraska, all the way up in South Dakota. Now it's this little small park right outside of Niobrara, Nebraska, that's just a little small piece of land that literally has 29 houses on it. That's it. Like, that's the Santee Sioux land, you know, and it used to be miles upon miles of vast lands, you know, going all the way into South Dakota. Not anymore. Not even close. So it's just, you know, I mean, it's not only them stealing lands, but it's also them trying to take advantage of the that they can't. And that's the biggest thing. Like, they bought